This is the day that God has made, and we are to rejoice and celebrate and worship together. Welcome to Plantation United Methodist Church, where we are a church for all God's people. I hope that you have gotten your bulletins, gotten online, those that are watching from home. I know that we are waiting for weather to come and go, but we are here to worship today and to give God thanks. I'm Reverend Dr. Marta Burke, Reverend Kathy Nolasco, Reverend Diane Gutierrez, that we will lead you in worship today. I hope that you all know that COVID is alive and well, and we do have face masks if you would like. It's optional. People have gotten sick, gotten better, myself included. I'm negative, don't worry. But we are being very, very careful and wanting you to feel comfortable, not to be anxious. As today, we will invite everyone for communion. You may take it as from the bread and the cup, or we have the individual little units of communion. We call it to-go communion, but you have that option. So we want to make sure everyone feels at ease and that we may celebrate God today. Know that if you need a mask, we have them in the back for you. And know that we will be able to help you and support you in any way we can. Do we have any first-time visitors today? First-time visitors. Okay. At first service, we had two or three, and there were so many that surprised us, didn't see any looking out there. I want to make sure we'll have a time for greeting at a distance and that we will come together and praise God. All right. Know again that everyone is welcome for communion today. The table is always open. Let us begin by preparing ourselves for worship. Let us listen as we hear the prelude. Thanks be to God. Let us stand, and Mr. Steve Higgins will lead us in our call to worship. You will see that on the screens.
We come to worship and gather around God's table.
We come to remember God's grace.
We've come to remember the story of God's love.
We come to be strengthened to share God's story.
We've come to be reminded that all are welcome here. We are all made in the image of God.
And are called to be one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world.
And let us all now join singing lustily the great Charles Wesley hymn, Maker in Whom We Live, hymn 88, and the words are on your screen.
God's people say? Amen. Amen. So today for our greeting time, we're going to do things a little bit differently. We're going to invite you, everyone, to turn this side, turn to that side, and say, good morning. Can you do that?
Good morning.
All right, now this side, say, God loves you, to that side.
God loves you.
All right, now turn to somebody else and say, glad you're here.
Glad you're here.
All right, and choose one more person and said, we are in God's house.
We are in God's house.
Anything? Anything to add, Pastor Marta?
Say amen. Amen.
All right. We invite you to
You may be seated. You all hold on to your pews. For those at home, hold on to your counters or your chairs, because so much is going on. This Saturday, folks, I'm so excited. We have been gifted a grant of over $7,000 for the General Board of Global Ministries for our youth so that they may understand and celebrate God's good creation, how we are to care for it, as well as how we are to care for one another. So from 11 to 2 on Saturday, we're inviting the whole community, youth, and from our sixth grade on up. But you can come out and peek. There's going to be rock climbing walls and
there's
jousting.
There's going to be a jousting in Connect Four and an inflatable and a dunk tank.
But what we're doing is we have a guest speaker. The chaplain from Florida A&M is coming down talking about some of what our responsibilities are. And then they're going to each station where they learn about how to take care of water, air, how they can have beach cleanups. They'll sign up over the next few months for different field trips down to the Everglades, beach cleanups, see turtles coming out. So it's going to be a blessing. So if you know of a youth, bring them here. We're hoping for at least 100 kids to come on out. So you come out and see yourself. So, but bring those young people, because this is something that I believe is going to get, I believe, national attention for what we can do in God's name. All right, we've got some other things. Ash Wednesday,
yes,
why don't you
Ash
share?
Ash Wednesday is coming up on February 14th. Yes, it's Valentine's Day. And so it is a week from Wednesday, and we are having an Ash Wednesday service at 7 p.m. that evening. Ash Wednesday, of course, is the beginning of the season of Lent, and Lent is a season of 40 days, not including Sundays, where we prepare ourselves for the death and resurrection of Christ leading up to Holy Week. And so Ash Wednesday marks the beginning of that season. It's a season of introspection and personal growth. And so you're invited to come Wednesday, Ash Wednesday, February 14th at 7 o'clock. We also have Ashes to Go in the mornings from 7 to 9.
On your way to work or on your way to school or just in the neighborhood, come on by. We're going to put ashes on your head. All right?
And so, you know, I said it earlier, they laughed. I said, you could come in the morning and then get ashed at night, too. You could do a double ashing. That would be fine.
And
so
then go home and, go home and take a bath. Okay. We also have a Lenten study that we're going to begin, and that is the third day. We'll, our men's group on Monday night, our women's, well, I will be offering a Wednesday at noon lunch bunch from 12 to 1. And so, but if there are others that would like to get the book, start their own group at home or with other friends in their neighborhood or here at the church, let me know. We hope you'll sign up because this will be starting after Ash Wednesday. All right, that's Wednesday after.
And last but not least, we have one event for children and their families. We have Kids Night In, which is also means it's Parents Night Out on February 16th.
Yes.
So this is for four-year-olds through fifth graders. So if parents, if you would like to be able to have your kids hang out and have fun at the church, and then you and your friends or your significant other can go out. So we would love to have them. Please, there's a QR code there. You can register their kids ahead of time or contact Paige Minich. She's our children's ministry coordinator, so that she can know how many kids to expect.
And always on our website. Please also pick up your newsletter today that we have in the back, and you can catch up on everything that's coming up. All right?
Speaking of kids, I think I see maybe Zalians, are there kids back there? I can't really tell.
Come on down.
Are there any kids? Can you come on up and hang out with me? And if there are any youth in the room that want to come up and pretend to be kids, I would allow that as well. I'm not going to look at them. But any kids, come on up.
Okay. Come on down. Oh, come
Syrian
on down.
Syrian Zali, please. Come. Pretty please.
Okay.
Oh, the girl, Tati and Maddie are coming too. Yay! We'll sit on the steps.
Yay.
Oh, and Josh is coming as well. Thanks, girls, for coming. We got 3 sixth graders here. They're honorary kids, but that's fine. You know, in the church, when you become a sixth grader, you become a youth. But you know, you're never too old to come up for the children's moment, right? All right, guys. Today, I want to talk about how you remember things. Do you guys ever forget to do things that you're supposed to do? Yeah, so your dad says, clean your room, and you say 2 hours later, I forgot. You ever do that, Josh? You ever do that, girls? Ever say, you need to, I know in our house, one of our children's, their job is to clean the litter box. And I'll ask them, How long has it been since you cleaned the litter box? 3 days. I forgot. You know, have you ever forgotten to do things like that? What kind of things do you forget to do?
Like clean your room.
Clean your rooms, yeah. What do you forget to do?
Homework.
Take out the trash. Homework? Oh, forget to do homework. Yes. Yes, those are all things that we forget to do. So there's some things that we can do to remind ourselves when we have something important we have to remember, right? So this is an old-fashioned way to remind yourself. A string around your finger, ever heard of that? This is probably before their time, really before my time, but what you can do is you can tie a string around your finger, and then when you feel the string, it's kind of, you always kind of feel it, you remember, oh, I have to do whatever it is I have to do today. So that's an old-fashioned way. One you might be familiar with to remind yourself is, what are these? You know what these are? Sticky notes, yes, these are my, these I use these a lot. You can ask anyone that comes in my office. All right, so these, if you have something you have to do, you stick it somewhere that you're going to see it, usually around your desk or computer or on your agenda book or refrigerator, I don't know. You have some place you put these? Not really? See, that's the problem, is that if you don't look at it or if you lose it, then you forget, right? Your phone, so I don't have my phone with me, it's over there, but there is an app on an iPhone, at least an iPhone, that's what I have, that's a Remind app. Have you used the Reminder app? And it's an app that, it's like a to-do list, and then you can set it to like make a notification or beep at you when you have to remember to do something. So forgetting things is kind of a human thing. It's been happening for a long time. We humans tend to forget things. And today, we are sharing today in Holy Communion, and that is what we're talking about today. And to Holy Communion is about remembering. It's about remembering. So when we take hope, we don't want to forget what Jesus did for us. And Holy Communion helps us to remember, is one way that we remember. So let's remember what Jesus did for us. Do you remember the story? So it was the last night of Jesus' life, remember that? And he's in the upper room and they're having dinner with his disciples, and he takes bread, right? And he breaks the bread and blesses it and he passes it around and said, "This is my body." The bread represents his body, which is given for you. And then he says what? "When you do this, remember me." An old translation says, "Do this in remembrance of me." But that means when you do this, when you eat the bread, remember me, right? And then he took up a cup of wine. We use grape juice. And he said, he blessed the wine and he shared it with his disciples. And he said, "When you, this is my blood, which is given for you." Then he said, "When you drink this cup, remember me," right? And so communion, I guess I didn't need my notes. I guess I knew the scripture. That's good. So communion is a way that we remember what Jesus did. We remember how Jesus gave his life for us on the cross. And then, because that happened the next day, right? So the Last Supper was on Thursday night, and then on Friday of that week, he died on the cross. And then what happened on Sunday of that week? Do you know? What happened 2 days after he died? Yeah, because he was alive. He was resurrected from the dead, right? And so communion, we remember that. Communion means a lot of other things. Pastor Marta's going to share about it in the sermon. So I hope you listen. But one of the things we do when we share in Holy Communion is we remember what God has done for us in Jesus, so that we don't forget. Because it's easy when we go out about our lives to forget how much God loves us, as made clear in his son Jesus. So you're going to come up for communion in the Methodist Church. All kids can take communion of all ages. And when you come up, I want you to hold your hands like this. And the pastor will give you, or one of the leaders will give you, a piece of bread. Can you do that, Josh? Like this. And one of the reasons, now if you have to take it, that's fine. But one of the reasons we do this is it reminds us that we are given this gift. It is a gift from God. And so we are receiving God's gift of Holy Communion, God's gift of his love, right? So that's what it reminds us of. And then when we get it, some people say amen in some churches. That's fine. Some people say thank you to the person giving it to them. But you know what I want to encourage us to say today? I want to encourage us to say, thanks be to God. Can you try that? Thanks be to God. Try it again. Thanks be to God. Congregation, try it with me. Ready? Thanks be to God. Because communion, we don't need to say thank you to the person physically giving. I mean, we could, but we're really thankful for what God has done. So we're thanking God. Because remember, communion is about remembering what God did through Jesus. So communion, we're thanking God. Thank you. Say thank you, God, or thanks be to God. And I just think it's a little more upbeat than saying amen. I mean, you can say amen, that's fine. But I think thanks be to God is a little bit more joyful ring to it. So today when you take communion, you hold your hands up, and when you get the bread, you say thanks be to God. You'll eat it, you take the cup, and you'll drink it, and you'll say thanks be to God. All right, and we will remember what God has done for us. Sound good? It's pretty good bread, so I hope you're excited about it. I know I'm excited about it. All right, shall we pray? The answer is yes. Right? The answer is yes. Ready to pray? Loving God, we remember you today for what you have done for us. Give us your grace and show us your love as we share in communion today. Help us to remember you. Amen. Amen. Thank you, children and honorary children, for coming up. You can go back to your seats. Let's continue in this time of prayer and reflection. And as we go before the Lord in prayer, I want you to think about someone that you know that needs prayer today. Maybe it's a loved one who's sick. Maybe they are just ill with a cold or something like that. Maybe they're struggling with their health, or maybe someone's struggling with a job situation or with an addiction, or maybe someone's dealing with some tough situations that they've been through and they're still processing that. I want you to think about those folks. I want you to lift them up as we are praying. I also want you to think about our community. There's been, of course, a lot of violence and things you hear about. You hear sirens all the time. So lift up our community and our community leaders. And lift up this world. It's been a lot of a very stressful week in the Middle East and everywhere else where there's violence and tension. It's a tense-filled time. So we lift up all the concerns on our hearts as we go to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray together. God, we are thankful for this time, for this beautiful sanctuary, this set-apart place where we can worship you, where we can gather with our brothers and sisters, where we can be fed by your Holy Spirit, by your grace, through music, through sermons, and yes, through Holy Communion. Lord, there is a line of storms coming, and that reminds us that when storms are in our lives, that you are present, that you are the anchor that holds, no matter how the waves might be trying to toss us. So we thank you, Lord, for holding on to us through whatever storm may come. We pray that our faith would ground us through all the uncertainty that we face. We lift up this world, Lord. And we pray that you would be with those whose lives have been upended by violence. We pray for peace. And we pray for the leaders of all these different nations and people groups. And Lord, we pray that peace would come. But we know it's complicated. So help us, Lord, to love one another and show peace in our own lives. We lift up this community of Plantation. We lift up our mayor. We lift up all who are in leadership. And we pray for guidance for them as well as they seek to make our community safer, as they seek to make our community a more welcoming place and a place that's more affordable for many people as well. Guide our leaders, Lord. We lift up those in our own circles of friends and coworkers and family. And we lift up those names that are on our hearts. Those people who are struggling, those people who are worried or anxious. We lift up physical health, but also mental health and emotional health and spiritual health. God, we are broken people, and we need your grace to ground us in our lives. So we pray that you would be with those who need you in a real way, and use us, Lord, to answer this prayer. Yeah. Show us who in our lives we need to reach out to, who we need to show love to, who we need to offer grace to, who we need to reconnect with, who we need to forgive, and who we need to love. Reveal those people to us, Lord, so that we can be your body, your hands and feet in this world. You rely on us, Lord, through your Holy Spirit to do your work. So show us how to do that. We pray these things in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us prepare to give of our tithes, our offerings, our gifts. As our ushers come, you may also place your Connect cards in there. And know that in the next few weeks, we will be sharing with you how we will move ahead with our offerings, our budget for the 2024 year, as we try to be the best stewards of God's grace and gifts we can be.
God of goodness, as we receive the gifts of bread and cup today, the gift of Jesus Christ himself, we ask that you would also receive our gifts to you. It is all yours to begin with. Thank you for entrusting us with these resources. Please help us use them to do good in the world. Resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 26. Hear these words. I received a tradition from the Lord, which I also had handed on to you. On the night on which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this to remember in me." He did the same thing with the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Every time you drink it, do this to remember me." Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you broadcast the death of the Lord until he comes again. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Grounded. Yes, we are grounded. No, you're not in trouble. It's okay. Every time I say that, I think about what my parents used to say. You're grounded. But we are grounded in God's faith, God's grace, God's goodness, God's joy. And today we are looking at to be grounded in communion. Yeah, communion. Can you remember the first time you took communion? I can remember as a preacher's, United Methodist preacher's kid, getting the communion elements after communion. You know, that's one of the perks. You got to eat the bread and finish the juice and all that kind of stuff. But that, can you remember your first time that you had communion? Maybe you learned about it in Sunday school. Maybe it was in confirmation. You went through confirmation class. Maybe that you walked up with your auntie or your mother or father. Or that maybe you just remember last month. We here at Plantation, we make sure at least once a month that we have communion on the first Sunday. But what does being grounded in communion mean? What is it? It's the meaning for us for communion. A couple weeks ago, right here in the sanctuary, we hosted and held the Emmaus Walk Spiritual Retreat Fellowship Time. Excuse me. And we had folks coming in from our community. We had dinner, we had fellowship, and then we came over here and had communion and a time of worship. Well, I came over a little bit early, open the doors, make sure everything was in place. And there was a young man at the back door. And he said, "May I come in and worship with you?" And I said, "Sure, it's going to be short and sweet, but come on in." I said, "We're serving communion." He says, "Oh, may I take communion with you?" And I said, "Sure, sure. Love for you to come up." And I introduced myself. He told me his name. His name is Carlos. And he says, "I'll sit in the back, so, you know, nobody." I said, "No, come on down, come on down." I went over later on, and after I blessed elements and before we gave them, I said, "Carlos, how did you hear about us? What does communion mean to you?" He says, "Marta, it means everything. It is my soul that God has given me, and my connection to live a life to the fullest." Wow. Yes. I looked at him and I said, "Are you kidding?" I said, "Would you like to preach Sunday?" We did find out as we began to talk, he was not only hungry for communion, but hungry for a meal, so we fed him a meal. And then we gathered his stuff and his shopping cart as we found out he was homeless, and we took him to where he was safe. That which feeds his soul, knowing that God connects him and makes him alive, is his meaning. But what is ours? How are we grounded in taking that little piece of bread and sharing in that little plastic cup? Well, I'm here to tell you there's a lot more today. And it is what we mentioned just a few weeks ago. It starts with the gift of grace. It is the heart and soul of what God has done with us and for us and yes, in the hope and the promise through us. Amen. Yeah. The passage of Paul's writings to Corinthians, let me tell you, those Corinth folks, they were a mess. Kind of like us, huh? They were folks that were new Christians and believers, and they were people with resources and wealth, yes, but they got the message all mixed up and messed up. Paul was so upset because he had told them to take the bread and share the cup and do this in remembrance of Jesus' life and death and resurrection. But what did they do? Well, it was kind of like a covered dish dinner, but they only invited their special friends. And once the food was gone, you know, that no one else got any more. Those that were there got the food, but not everybody was invited. Yeah. That they used this time for their own personal gain, their own purpose. And so Paul was trying to tell them, no, you're missing the point. This is not the message. This is not what is grounded in the Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper. It's so much more. It is that of God's grace given for all of God's people, the believers, the non-believers, those the poor, the rich, the young, the old, the persons of color and culture, and yes, for the diversity of beliefs. God's here for every last one of us, just as we are. Lord, help him, because we're a mess, aren't we? I read again and again those folks in Corinth and think, God, you love them so you can love us. What happens with communion? What takes place? And I want to make sure we're clear and understand. There are four things that happen in action with it. And we do it just automatically. So let me share with you. The first thing is we take. We present the common elements of bread and wine, or in our arena, it's grape juice, okay? Or maybe cranberry juice with a little grape in it. Anyway, do you know that one of the founders of AA grew up in the United Methodist Church? Because he wanted to take communion, it was so important, and at that time they just served wine, and when he even had that little bit of wine, it sent him spiraling. And so he created this ministry that is now a global phenomenon of healing and wholeness. We first take. We take it, and then we bless it. We bless those in that action. We take the common elements of a loaf of bread. Yes, we get our bread from Publix, all right? Thank you, Publix, the good bread. And that we bless it in God's name. The third thing is that we actually, you can see it when we break the bread and we lift the cup, that we see it, the reality of it. And then, yes, we give it and share it. It happens just like that, doesn't it? It happens so quick. But to know the actions that are going on, that each is part of a step that can process and transform us. You're probably going, well, we take it, I bless it, I break it, we share it, so, and then we go home, right? That's when it just begins, brothers and sisters. The Holy Communion is both a proclamation and, listen to me, a transformation. You think you're just walking down the aisle and getting a piece of bread and a cup. You know that we say when we have a conversion experience, when we come to the altar and we give our life to Christ, well, each time you come for Holy Communion, you come to this holy table, it is a can be a transformation moment if we are grounded in knowing what it means and allowing God to be part of our lives in that way. We say the liturgy, the great Thanksgiving. We praise God, and we talk, and as Pastor Kathy mentioned, one of the elements is we remember that life, death, and resurrection and the story of Jesus' life, the parables, the moments. But that's at the heart, but it's also allowing ourselves to be transformed by the Spirit of God as we take the bread and share the cup. In some traditions, particularly in our brothers and sisters in the Catholic Church, they feel it transforms into the actual body and blood. We see it as a symbolic moment. But it's what that symbol does in transforming us, and then what we do with it in the world around us, that it just doesn't stay at the altar or in your stomach. It becomes part of us. It becomes part of who we are. And it's what we're to do in this world with that. We're good United Methodist. I love being a United Methodist. And as I was working at Wesley Chapel in London, I got indoctrinated very quickly. They had prayers in the morning, prayers at noon, prayers at evening, and everybody had to show up. I said, this is being worse than a preacher's kid going to church every Sunday. Not worse, but definitely every day we had communion. And I thought, why? But it became part of me. It became an important spiritual discipline for me. And part of me in my life, that communion is something that I need as much as I can get. Because this is a moment of transformation. How can we, and especially as United Methodists, I love the hymns, thank you, Pastor Kathy, that lifts up John and Charles Wesley's words of communion and lifting us up of our theology of hope and promise and grace for all. Yes, we take it, we bless it, we break it, we share it, but how do we be grounded in that? Let's look. There are four things I want to suggest that we have that will help us ground, and especially not just in our own lives, but as a family of God in our own church here at Plantation. First, come to the Lord's table as often as you can. And I want to offer that if there is those that request that you want more, let me know. Let me know. Just as John Wesley's Chapel had it every day. Maybe on your way to work. Maybe there's another opportunity that we can have special services for that. But we should have it as often. You should have it in your life as often as you can. I know when I was at Leesburg at our youth camp, when we had communion one time and we didn't have the bread or the juice, so we used RC Cola and saltine crackers. The pastor blessed them, and guess what? It was a moment I will never forget. A moment of new beginnings. A moment of seeing God in so many different ways and bringing God's grace to all of us. Secondly, we come to the Lord's table with love for others. How many of us have our agendas, our things that block us from loving someone? Maybe we're in the midst of indecisiveness or argument with someone or tension with someone. We need to come to the Lord's table for love for others. Today, you thought of someone in your prayer time that you needed to lift up. I want you also to think of a person that you need to love. Not smother, but love them. And maybe it's someone it's difficult to love. Yeah, it's hard. That we need to learn how to love and come to the table with that. That God can transform us and help us. The third thing I think that will help us be grounded is come to the Lord's table with remembrance of the Lord. Yes, we need to remember that Christ came for us. God gave his only son, lived among us, died for us, suffered. Yeah, you think we have to suffer? Think what he went through. Those of his personal friends that denied him, those that left him, those that rejected him, those that killed him. And yet, he gave it up for us. He gave it for us all. And he rose again. And last, come to the Lord's table with examination of yourself, of ourselves. We are needing to be transformed. We are needing to see where God can recreate us and hold us and, yes, call us to what God has called us to do. It's not easy. And one might say, I'm too old for that. Or I've got another agenda. It's not our agenda. It's what God wants for us, what God has called us to do. There was a young couple having their second child. And their first child was 4 or 5 years old, and they'd grown up in the church, but so much had happened. Parents had gotten new jobs, that second child had come about. They'd gotten away from the church. But the little boy says, I want to talk to my new sister when you bring her home. And the father said, well, your little sister is a gift from God, and she'll be there in the crib, but we'll have to be real careful. And he said, I want to talk to her alone. Well, the parents said, okay. So they cracked the door and listened in. And they said, I'm sure they had a monitor there to make sure everything was okay. And he went over to his sister's crib and peeked through the slats and said, you're a gift from God. Can you tell me more about God? Because I've kind of forgotten what he's like. Have we forgotten? Have we become disconnected? Can we become grounded in this communion moment, that it becomes part of who we are and who God wants us to be, as God's grace is there for all of us? Brothers and sisters, as you come for communion today, let's see if we can do it often. Let's see if we can come in love for others. Let us remember the gift that God gave us through his Son, Jesus Christ, and let us do so as we examine and begin to be transformed by this holy meal. There's no leftovers up here. It's the real thing. So let us be grounded in God's communion of grace for all God's people. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Amen. Know that all are welcome to the communion table, and we celebrate this today.
You'll be invited to follow along with the liturgies that will be on the screen. So I invite you to join me in reading responsibly as we begin this holy great Thanksgiving. The Holy One be with you.
And also with you.
Open your hearts to the one who is love.
We open our hearts to you, O God.
Let us give thanks to God who welcomes the stranger.
To the one who reaches across every border, we give thanks and praise.
In wonder of your expansive embrace, we give you praise, O God. Through your radical welcome, you reveal the limitations of our own imaginations. You break down walls and boundaries we don't even realize we have erected. Like the Magi guided by the light of star through foreign territory, you, God, call us all towards you. You lead us, your people, across borders of hate and into lands of forgiveness and love. You strengthen us as we journey, learning and unlearning stories about one another. Gathered in your presence, we come to recognize the gifts of community, rich in diversity. Therefore, we join our voices with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, singing praise to you in the response.
Holy, holy, holy One, God of justice and love, heaven and earth are full of your wonder. Hosanna among us.
You move in mysterious way, O God. This journey with you is filled with more questions than answers. Each time we think we have you figured out, you surprise us again, revealing yourself in new ways. In Jesus, we saw your radical welcome of strangers, extended in challenging ways, ways that disrupt our traditions and unsettle our comfort zones. Jesus broke religious rules in order to include all people. He lifted up the sacredness of the people in places deemed unclean. He cared more about the well-being of the oppressed than his own reputation. Jesus taught us to rethink your presence among us, but we couldn't accept it, resist transformation. Your people sent him to the cross.
Now, on that night of his arrest, Jesus shared a meal with his companions. He took the bread, blessed it, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said this, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal, He took the cup, blessed it, and shared it, saying, "This is the cup that is poured out. It is a new covenant." So in remembrance of all you have done to save us, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Let us proclaim together the following. Christ was birthed among us. Christ was killed among us.
Christ rising again among us.
Now may the same Spirit that lifted Christ from the grave be poured out on these gifts. Make this bread and this cup be for the extension of the welcome that knows no bounds. Fill us with the courage and faith to join you in work of tearing down walls that exclude and pointing to the sacred in the margins. Come, let us feast at the table. I'll invite those that are helping with communion today to please come forward at this time.
Body of Christ broken for you.
The bread of life, the cup of salvation.
The body of Christ broken for you.
The bread of life taken and eat. Thank you.
The body of Christ broken for you.
Taken and eat. Thank you so much.
Thank
you.
Let us pray. God, the meal we've shared together in this moment is a remembrance of your radical embrace of the outcast and the oppressed. May it strengthen us as we open our minds and hearts to new ways of recognizing your presence among us. Transform us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and sing together our closing hymn, I Come With Joy.
Today, Nellie Duncan is 100 years young, and she celebrates her birthday with her family this afternoon. So keep them in your thoughts and prayers as they celebrate, and hope that we all reach 100. Now, with the joy of the Lord that is our strength, and being grounded in the communion of God's holy meal, let us go out these doors and share that with the world, a meal that is eternal. A meal that is transforming, a meal that is filled with grace and God's love for all God's people. And let the people say, Amen. Amen.